to our very first online lecture. Before we start, check temp muna tayo. Bang! Baduy mo, sir. Okay, anyway, so welcome. I'm Engineer Guanzon and I will be your instructor or I will be your facilitator for this subject throughout the short term. Okay? As much as I would actually like to teach you guys face to face, with the current situation we are in, it is impossible. Okay? And I would, syempre, most of us would prefer we do it this way for us to be safe. Given the situation, given the circumstance, wala na tayong no choice kung di mag-adapt. Di ba? Sanay naman tayo dun yung lagi tayo nag-a-adjust. So, adjust na lang tayo. So anyways, this is now Geotechnical Engineering 3. I am under the assumption or the presumption that you are actually finished now with Geotech 1 and Geotech 2 as this is the third Geotech course in your curriculum. So of course, I will be expecting now that you're actually knowledgeable with the terms and with the basic knowledge that should have been garnered from Geotech 1 and Geotech 2. For an introduction first, our syllabus now for Geotech 3 would be for the, supposedly because this subject is to be taken during the regular SEMS, during the first or second semester, its timeline is not supposedly fitting now for a short term. But anyways, we will do our best so you students could get your money's worth. The prelims supposedly should consist of lateral earth pressure, lateral forces, and the design of retaining walls, and the different types of cases now that would befall our retaining walls. Now, for the midterms, it would be mainly about soil-bearing capacity or the capacity now of your soil to carry load. It is now an analysis for both shallow and deep foundations. Next up, for finals, if ever we reach this topic here, it would be under slope protection. We are to check the different modes of failure of our typical slopes. Okay, so that is that. What makes civil engineering, what makes geotechnical engineering crucial? If you were to ask me, I find it one of the most crucial aspects or branches now of civil engineering. Why is that? If you were to consider every structure that you could think of, whether they be bridges, whether they be roads, whether we have our buildings, different buildings, high-rise structures, we even have Burj Khalifa and the like, all of these structures are actually at one point in contact with soil. Lahat yan nakadikit sa lupa. And they are expecting now or they are transferring their weight or their load to the soil. And it's like asking the soil to help them carry this weight or to carry it all. Ganun, parang ganun. So if ever the soil fails or the data that you could get from soil investigations were actually faulty, that is now holding paramount responsibility. Sipin mo dahil mali yung investigation report mo, mali yung binigay mong data sa structural engineer, nag-design siya ngayon ng foundation that is not sufficient for the given soil bearing capacity, in the end, nagkaroon ng shear failure, tumumba yung building. Plak! Ganun. Plak! Ganun. No? So, sinong sisisihin yan? Yung structural engineer o yung geotechnical engineer? After a thorough investigation, seeing as is the structural engineer did his part, considered a design, now made a design that is actually sufficient for the given soil bearing capacity, tas yung geotechnical engineer pala nakita na masyadong malaki yung binigay na soil bearing capacity when it is actually lower. You are held responsible for whatever happened. And for me, that is why I believe geotechnical engineering is very, what you call this? Very important. And it is very crucial that you have allowance for factor of safety and the like, because soil is actually very unpredictable. So that's that for geotechnical engineering as a whole and why I find it very important. So consider now the course we have here, CE522. For the prelims, we will be focusing on lateral forces acting on soil, or the forces that is being produced by soil. That is now what we would call our lateral earth pressure or lateral earth force. And this is now the data that is needed for us to actually design our retaining walls. I believe you are familiar with the retaining wall. So you have been studying in Baguio, you would have seen several retaining walls all around the city and even on your trips going home and about. So that's that. Let's go for a small recap of your knowledge from the previous soil engineering subjects. You should, one of the crucial knowledge that you should have right now would be the concept of effective stress, taken from Geotech 2. Effective stress will be here all throughout our course. It will be all throughout prelims, midterms, and finals, so I hope you have a good knowledge on it. Another one would be the strength parameters of soil. Namely, we have our cohesion and we have our angle of friction. So, as a recap, let's have now a soil sample under a random depth underneath the soil as surface. You should know by now that this soil sample here is actually subjected to pressure, okay, or stress that is now both horizontal and vertical. Yung vertical natin dyan, that is what we actually call now our sigma prime. Let's maybe just denote it with, let's say V, okay? So we have our sigma prime V denoting I, being an example of vertical effective stress. If you have a vertical effective stress, then there is bound to be a horizontal effective stress. This is a common knowledge supposedly for Geo2 passers, kasi this has been tackled there already. How do we solve for effective stress? Vertical effective stress, how do we solve for effective stress? That is simply effective unit weight or effective gamma or gamma prime multiplied by depth H. Depth H of your soil sample. Okay? So that is that. That is now your sigma prime V. Or your vertical effective stress. Now given that, how do we solve now for a horizontal effective stress? That is now your sigma prime H. In order to get this, you simply have now your vertical stress multiplied by a lateral earth coefficient, or we will now be denoting that with K. Okay? And K now is multiplied by your vertical effective stress, resulting now into horizontal stress. Or that is simply gamma prime multiplied by H. This is the basic concept that we will be making use of for the analysis of lateral earth pressure. Now I have given you your module, the first module, hoping now that while you are watching this video lecture, you have now the module printed or at least open in another tab so you can follow the discussion. Please try to understand that. From that you will see that we have our K or our lateral earth coefficient being now equal to sigma prime of H all over now our sigma prime V. Okay? So that is that. That is now given in your module. Let me try to open it. Three types of cases. There you go. Oh, it's too long. Okay. Anyways, there. So, it is the module where you can see this figure here. With regards to that, we have our retaining walls class. Retaining walls are actually under three different cases. as shown in the picture below on the screen. Cool, no? Inaaral ko yan. Tinuro ni Sir Segundo kung paano gamitin yan, di ba? Oh, di ba? You see this picture here? Boom, pwede na ako mag-streamer. ML, tas nandyan yung picture ko sa kanto. Anyways, let's go back to our lesson. So there are actually three possible cases now whenever we are talking about lateral earth pressure. We have now the typical at rest, we have now active case, and we have also the passive case. What are the differences? Let's say I have now a retaining wall situated here. And this is now my body of soil. If ever the case be that there is no yielding happening, or the retaining wall I have is centered and it is not moving towards or away from the soil, that is now at rest conditions or at rest case. If ever now, because of a soil failure, the production of a failure wedge here, nag-fail yung soil natin ng ganyan, it had to fall, and now my retaining wall is leaning away from my soil body, this is now under the active case. Now, if there may be a circumstance wherein the wall now is actually leaning towards my soil body, this would be under the passive condition. Sir, bakit naman maglilin yung wall papunta sa soil body? That doesn't necessarily happen naturally. Okay? Pero sabihin natin, may backhoe dito, tinulak niya yung wall. Kapag ba tinulak niya yung wall, maglilin na towards the soil body? Yes, that is one case. What would be another case? Another case is, paano pag lumindol ng sobrang lakas at nagkaroon ng lateral force that actually push now your wall towards the soil layer? That is also a possibility. Another one would be engineering intervention. Sabihin natin, you are now putting up braces that are actually pushing your wall towards your soil. Either way, in any case, as long as the wall is pushing towards the soil, that is under the passive condition or the passive case. So that's that. That is the basic explanation. In solving now for lateral earth pressure, what is the main reason why we are solving for lateral earth pressure? Solving for lateral earth pressure because this would be now the basis for the design of your retaining walls. It would simply be like the analysis of a cantilevered beam and there is now a load on top of it. Parang ganun lang yung pag-design natin ng retaining walls class. Well, given that, more or less it's similar. Let's go now to the process of how do you actually solve for the lateral earth pressure? Paano ba iso-solve yun, sir? Well, one of the most crucial things about this, you're already familiar with vertical effective stress. Alam nyo na yan. Ano yung dun sa mga dinrowing ko kanina sa pinakita ko with your K, sigma prime V, what is now a concept that is new to you? Definitely, it would be the value of K. Sir, paano kunin yung value ng K? Or that is your lateral earth coefficient. Now, the value of K would differ now per case. Whether it be at rest, passive, or active, magiging iba yung formula na gagamitin natin. When we are talking about at rest conditions, K is simply equal to 1 minus sine of T. That is that. That is also in your module. Just read on it. I believe that is the basic gist of lateral earth pressure and design of retaining walls. Let's try to go over the problems that I have included in your module. Medyo parang fake yung whiteboard ko, hindi ko ma-erase. Okay, kung alam nyo kung paano ko lilinisin tong whiteboard bukas, comment your suggestion, no? So, for your problems, let's have this. Again, this is now provided, this is given in your module. Palitin natin at medyo kinain niya na yung screen. Okay, so let's try to solve for problem number one. problem number one, we have now a retaining wall. There is no yielding involved. There is no yielding mentioned. So more or less, it is at rest conditions. So we have now a retaining wall. Di bali class, i-zoom in ko na lang dito yung camera mamaya. Or lalapit ko na lang yung board. So we have now a retaining wall here and it is of a height 7 meters. It is given that gamma is equal now to 17.8 kilonewtons per cubic meter. And we have now an angle of friction equal to 34 degrees. I believe this is all that is given, and now we are being asked to determine the lateral earth force at rest per unit length of the wall and determine the location of the resultant force. Okay, in solving now for in solving for our lateral force, I believe you're also familiar with the concept of pressure diagrams from GO2. I remember we were solving pressure diagrams under vertical effective stress back in GO2. More or less, this is the same concept, only with the addition now of a lateral earth coefficient. So that's the only thing that's new here. So since yun din yung bago at yun yung hindi natin sure, it is actually the first step in solving for the lateral earth force. So now let's have our value of K. Again, K is simply equal to 1 minus sine of phi. We have a given phi from the problem, and because of that, we can immediately solve for our value of K. That is now 1 minus sine of 34 degrees. Okay, please compute. Nakamiss, kaya gusto ko rin yung face-to-face. Hindi na ako nagka-calculator, no? Sisisihin ko na lang kayo pag mali yung sagot nyo. Anyways, we have this 1 minus sine 34. Okay. The value now is equal to 0.441. That's now the value of my lateral earth coefficient for this specific soil profile. Now, given that, I could immediately go and solve now for the changes of effective stress, horizontal effective stress per soil depth, sorry. So, given this now, again, we could solve for the value of my lateral earth pressure, or that is now my sigma prime H, that is simply equal now to coefficient K multiplied by sigma prime V. Or if we were to expand that, it would simply be gamma prime multiplied by a depth H. So this will be our working formula in solving for the effective stress per depth. Okay? So, given that, let's try to consider now at a depth of 0 meter sa pinakataas ng soil natin at this part here. At this part, there is there any horizontal stress or lateral pressure present at that ground surface? Let's check. Okay. Sigma prime H, again, is equal to K. K being 0.441. Multiplied by our gamma prime, that is effective unit weight. We are given unit weight dry. What is effective unit weight? Effective unit weight is simply unit weight minus your water unit weight, or that is 9.81 in SI units. Is there a presence of groundwater in this problem here? A 1. So our effective unit weight is equal now to dry unit weight. Therefore, K is 0.441 and unit weight is now equal to 17.8. Now, what is my H at a depth of 0 meter, or at this part here on top? Meron na bang kine-carry na soil on top of it? Wala pa. So, this is now multiplied by 0. So, the effective horizontal or the lateral earth pressure at the 0 meter depth is actually equal to 0. Let's check now at the bottom, at the 7 meter depth. At the 7 meter depth now, sigma prime of H, again, it is still the same process, is equal now to 0.441 multiplied by unit weight 17.8 multiplied by now a depth of 7 meters. Given this, the value of my lateral earth pressure at the bottom or at the leg, at the footing of my retaining wall is equal to 0.441 times 7 equal to 54.949. This is now in, what is the unit of this now? Our unit weight is given as kilonewtons per cubic meter. The depth 7 is equal, is in meters. So cancel out the m, we are left with squared, or we are now left with kilonewtons per meter squared, or in other words, that is now kilopascals. Okay. So this is the lateral pressure at the bottom of our wall. But is this what is being asked of us? No. This is the lateral earth pressure. We are being asked now for the lateral earth force. And to solve for that, you are simply now to draw a pressure diagram. I hope you are still familiar with your pressure diagrams. Let's try to draw one. Our pressure diagrams now, in the y-axis would be your depth in terms of z. And on our x-axis, the graph would be in terms of sigma prime h, or the value of your lateral earth pressure. Yan yung susundan natin. Now, let's try to plot our diagram now. At the 0 meter depth or on top of it, we have a value of 0 kPa for sigma prime h. So, we will start off at 0. And as we go down the soil at a depth of 7 meters, we have now a value of 54.949 kPa. This increase is actually linear, class. Ha? Linear increase lang ito. So, linear increase hanggang dyan, you'd have a value of 54.949. Okay? Close it now. It is simply a square. Siyempre, triangle na. Triangle, it is of a shape of a triangle. And in order to get now the value of your lateral earth force, is simply computing now for the area of this shape here. And we are thankful that it is a triangle. Napaka-basic. So, at first, madali pa. Actually, until how many complicated layers of soil will be given, the concept is still the same. Mas may additional challenge na. Pero it is simply taking the area of the pressure diagram. Di ba basic lang nung ginawa natin? All throughout prelims, it is more or less the same process. Solve for a value of K. Solve for the lateral earth pressure per depth. And plot your diagram. And simply take the area now. So what is the area of this given triangle? It is simply 1/2 base times height. Our base being 54.949. Multiplied by a height of what? What is the total height of my retaining wall? That is 7. Multiplied by 7. And this is now equal to 54.949 times 7 by 192.322. Okay? So, ano yung unit niyan? Create natin yung problem ulit. Or let's transfer it here. Or dyan. Or wag. Or tabo muna natin. Yan. So, what is this unit 192.322? Well, we have our kilopascal here, and that is in kilonewton per meter squared. And again, it is multiplied by a depth in meters. Okay? So, magka-cancel yung meter-meter. This is now under kilonewtons per meter. Pero sir, di ba force yan? Bakit may per meter? Di ba sir, pagka-force, kilonewton lang yung unit niya? This is now the value of your lateral earth force per unit length. Unit meter of the wall. Wala namang sinabing thickness sa problem, di ba? What if it was actually stated that the wall is 4 meters thick? Or 4 meters thick, sorry. 4 meters wide width yung pinag-uusapan. Paano kung mahaba siya 4 meters wide? What would happen now to the value of the lateral earth force? You simply multiply this by 4, magka-cancel yung M, and you're left now with kilonewton unit, or that is now the total force of a 4 meter wide retaining wall. Okay? So this is now your answer. But we are also being asked for the location of the lateral earth force, because that is a force that is acting on one point of the depth. So where is it acting on? It is now acting on the centroid of my pressure diagram. What is the centroid of a triangle? It is of course 1/3 of the height. So therefore y bar, or that is now the location from the bottom, is equal to 7/3 meters. 7/3, or that is equal to 2.333 meters from the base of the wall. Answer! Boom! Okay, copy! Wait, lapit ko pala. Ang hirap. Yan! Boom! Okay, pause! Okay na. Then, so more or less, we'll be trying to do our lectures like this from now on. Let's move on to the second problem. Okay, so let's go over now our second problem. Boom, magic na. So let's have our second problem here. Now this time we have the presence of groundwater in our retaining wall. We have an 8 meter high wall. The groundwater is now located 3 meters below the surface. And again, we are being asked for the lateral earth force. Similar, like I said, everything is similar to the first problem we did. Yung process ng pag-solve would be more or less the same. First one would be solving now for the value of our coefficient k. Again, that is 1 minus sine of phi. This time, we have our phi equal to 25. So, the value of k is equal to 0.577. Okay. Given the value of k, now we could go ahead and compute for the value of lateral earth pressure per depth of our soil. Here we have two contributing values to this lateral earth pressure. We have the value of our gamma from the dry soil, and we have the value of our gamma sat contributing now to the lateral earth pressure. There are actually many ways to solve this. You will probably find books now that will be teaching a different method. It is solving everything in one go. For me, I find it easier now to separate solving. What do you mean, sir? Solve natin ang hiwala yung contribution ng dry soil at saka yung contribution ng saturated soil sa lateral earth pressure. In regards to that, I'll show you through example now. Due to the effects of gamma 1. Okay? Again, at the 0 meter depth, or at this point here, we have now our lateral earth pressure equal to 0 kPa. Automatically, because there is still no soil above it, it is not carrying anything. Now, let's go to where it is actually bound to change. That is now in 3 meters. After 3 meters of depth, there is bound to be an effect now with the lateral earth pressure. Andito pa din ako. So, at 3 meters, let's consider now our lateral earth pressure, sigma prime H is equal to K 0.577 multiplied by our effective gamma. Again, this is effective unit weight. On top, now we have dry unit weight. So, the dry unit weight is equal to the effective unit weight. So, this is simply equal to 16 kilonewtons per cubic meter. And now, what is the depth of the soil that this part is actually carrying? It is now 3 meters worth of soil, or a thickness of 3 meters. So, at a depth of 3 meters, the lateral earth pressure due to gamma 1 is equal to 27.696. While you're watching this video, I'd appreciate it if you try to bring out your calculators and to solve with me. It's one thing now to know how I brought out those values. Eh, di kung mali, tas mali pala yung value, kung mali yung pag-calculate ko. You can comment it on our Google Classroom. Again, also if you have any questions regarding the lecture, You can always contact me through the G Classroom. I'm opening it from time to time. You could put your comments there. Okay? So this is now in KPA. This is the value of our lateral earth pressure at 3 meters due to gamma 1. How about at a depth of 8 meters? At the 8 meter depth, what is the value of our lateral earth pressure? Lateral earth pressure again is equal to K 0.577 multiplied by due to gamma 1, diba? So this is now 16 multiplied by what depth? Anong depth yung tinutukoy natin dito? Would it be equal to 8? If you said 8, wrong. Okay? It should only be equal to 3. Gamma 1 is only comprised of 3 meters of thickness. Ito lang sa taas. Ibang gamma na yung nandito sa baba. We are considering the effects at 8 meters deep. Dito sa 8 meters na to, kapag nasa 8 meters ka ba, hindi mo na binubuhat yung dry soil sa taas? Binubuhat pa din. This soil here is carrying everything on top of it. Okay? All throughout yan. It is carrying the weight of the 3-meter soil and it is also carrying the weight of the 5-meter soil. So that is that. So this is simply equal to 27.696 kPa per kilonewtons per meter squared. Okay? So this is due to the effects of gamma 1. Let's try to calculate now the effects due to the gamma sat. Due to gamma sat. Obviously, at the point 0 meter, that is equal to 0. The lateral earth pressure is equal to 0. So, let's move forward at 3 meters. So, at a depth of 3 meters, what is the lateral earth pressure caused by the gamma sat soil or the saturated soil? Again, if you only have one formula, this is now sigma prime H is equal to is equal now to K 0.577 multiplied by effective unit weight, but we're referring to gamma sat. How do I take now the effective unit weight when saturated unit weight is given? I simply subtract from the saturated unit weight the unit weight of water. So that is now saturated unit weight, which is 22, minus the unit weight of water, 9.81. That is, of course, in SI units. Okay? So that's that. Also, multiplied by the depth. Ano yung depth ng gamma sat or ng saturated soil at 3 meters? Dito. 3? Wrong. 0. The saturated soil starts here, so there is no saturated soil on top or above it. So meaning there is still no contribution to the lateral earth pressure at a depth of 3 meters. So this is now 0. But if we were to move forward further or deeper, it is now going to at a depth of 8 meters. We have now sigma prime of H is equal to 0.577. Kikita ba? Nakikita ba sa board? Kita no? Ayos, at least you can read. Pause nyo na lang. So, 0.577, we have now 22 minus 9.81. And this is now multiplied by what depth of the saturated soil? Would it be 8? Wrong. 5 meters lang yung thickness ng saturated soil natin. And that is the only thing we are considering. Mahirap. Ayan. Multiplied by 5. Okay, so the value of lateral earth pressure caused by the saturated soil at the 8 meter depth would be 35.168 kPa. So that is that. We can now go ahead and draw our pressure diagram, correct? Wrong. Why is that? Itong lupa lang ba yung nire-retain nung retaining wall natin? Is soil 1 and saturated soil the only ones that are contributing to lateral pressure or pressure against our retaining wall? Imagine this is our retaining wall. Yung lupa lang ba yung ina-hold back niya?
Hindi. Ano pa? There is actually the presence of groundwater here. Okay? There is groundwater here, and of course, that is also pushing towards our wall. That is also a force or a stress that is to be considered when designing our retaining wall. So, how do we go about and solve for that? Sir, ba't pa natin siya isosolve? Ba't hindi na lang natin sinolve na saturated dito? Ba't hindi na lang natin tinanggal? You will see here. In order to solve for that force that is now caused by water, let's try to denote this as mu. That is simply equal to the unit weight of water, 9.81, multiplied by the total depth of water, which in this case is 5 meters. So, mu is equal to 49.05. This is also an added pressure on the wall. Sir, bakit kinailangan pa natin tanggalin sa saturated unit weight? Tapos idadagdag lang din pala natin dito. What is the difference in the process that we actually did? If we were to simply consider now gamma sat in the saturated soil at hindi na natin ginamit yung effective na unit weight, we will be multiplying the unit weight, we will be multiplying now the pressure of water with the coefficient K. That is wrong. Itong K na to, nag-a-apply lang to dun sa soil natin with the property of phi equal to 25 degrees. Sir, bakit hindi siya nag-a-apply sa water? Go back to your fluid mechanics with the design of dams. Did we ever multiply a coefficient when considering the overturning moment of dams? Hindi, di ba? Let's have a better analogy. Kunwari, I have a retaining wall right here. Tapos eto lupa. Lupa. Pag tinanggal ko ba yung retaining wall, automatically will the soil flow? Parang aagos na lang? Depende, di ba? Depende sa type of soil, but not in the form of water. Kasi if you would imagine if this was water or this was a dam, tapos tinanggal ko ngayon yung dam, automatically it will flow. There is no resistance being caused by an angle of friction because water does not have an angle of friction. So we have to separate now water in our computations. Now that we have all the values, we could actually go ahead now and draw our pressure diagrams. Let's put it now in a simplified manner. Let's consider the pressure diagram being caused about by our gamma 1. Gamma 1 here. So gamma 1 at point 0. At point 0 now, we have a value of 0 kPa right here. So this is now 0. Up until now, the 3 meter depth, mag-i-increase siya linearly. Okay? Up to a value of 27.696 kPa. Now, that is at the 3 meter depth. But if you would look now at the 8 meter depth, 27.696 pa din siya. Bakit ganon? There is no change. Okay? So, this is now the pressure diagram that is caused by our gamma 1. Let's consider now the pressure diagram of our gamma 2. Or gamma sat, sorry. Gamma sat now. At the 0 meter depth, at 0 depth, walang value. Okay? Wala siyang value. It has no value here. At the 3 meter depth, again, it does not have value. This is due to gamma sat. Ito yung sinolve natin dito. Okay? But if you go now to the 8 meter depth, there is a linear increase of 35.168. Okay? So that's that. Are we finished? No, we still need to consider now the pressure diagram caused by our water. And it is similar now to our saturated diagram. This would start here at the 3 meter depth and end there with a value of 49.05 kPa. Now, given all of that, we could actually make our lives easier by subdividing this into different areas. Kasi di ba kukunin pa rin natin yung areas? We are still to take the areas or the total areas now of this, and that will now be the lateral earth force. how do you solve for the areas? We have two triangles and this, what shape is this? We're not sure. It could be a star for all we care. But we could divide it into two familiar shapes. Pag hinati ko dyan, I'm now left with a triangle and with a rectangle. So let me call that my area 1 and my area 2. This will now be my area 3 and this will be my area 4. Solving for the areas individually. My total lateral force now, area 1 is equal to 110.784. 696 times a depth of B divided by 2. Wait, wrong. Erase. O, diba? Kaya gusto ko na i-solve kayo. Okay, again, let's solve this. 27.696 times a depth of 3 divided by 2. This is a triangle. So, area 1 is 41.544. Area 2 is 27.696 times the depth of 5 plus 138.48 plus now our area 4 that is 35.168 times the depth of 5 divided by 2. This is now 87.92. And lastly, 49.05 times 5 divided by 2. 122.625. Okay. 122.625. If I were to take the summation now, 41.544 plus 138.48 plus 87.92 plus 122.625. Our total lateral force now has a value of 390.569. Of course, this is in kilonewtons per unit meter of the wall. Okay? Now, how do we solve for the location of the lateral force? The previous example, it was simply in the centroid of our diagram. Ganun din dito because this is actually in some of the review materials that you will be seeing in some of the instructor's notes. Magkakadikit yung mga diagrams nila. And if ever that were the case, you are simply to take the centroid. So how do we take now the centroid of this total pressure diagram? We make use of mechanics, Barignon's theorem, wherein we have area total multiplied by y bar, or that is now your location from the base of our wall. This is now equal to area 1 multiplied by y1 of course being the centroid of number 1. So how do we get the centroid of number 1? We have this depth here of 5 meters, and on top of it this is 3 meters. Paano kunin yung centroid niya from the bottom? That would be 5 plus 1 third of 3, so that is simply 6. Ganon yung concept niya. Plus area 2 multiplied by y2 plus area 3 y3 area 4 y4. Just note it as an yn. Okay? Pag imamanual ko siya, automatic y bar is equal to, na-analyze ko, wait lang, 2.81 meters. Wait, try natin ulit. If I were to calculate it, 41.544, y1 is equal to 6, plus 138.48, its centroid is at 2.5, 67.92, 5 thirds, plus 122.625, again, 5 thirds, divided by... Okay. Try to bring this value out. This is now 2.423 meters. That is now measured from the base of the wall. Again, I'll bring it closer. Yan. Problem number 2. Done. Okay, so we have one more problem. Problem number three. Okay, problem number three. Boom, may sagot na. What does that mean? I would like you to solve for problem number three on your own. Try to bring out these answers here. Okay? So, what is the main difference between problem 2 and problem 3? Meron tayong surcharge sa problem 3. Okay? There is now a surcharge on top of the soil layer. That is at 15 kPa. Now, what is the effect of this 15 kPa? Recall nyo from GU2, up until the bottom or kahit sa ang infinite depth ng soil na to, it will be carrying that load 15 kPa. But it is vertical. We are talking about lateral earth pressure, so we are supposed to convert that vertical surcharge into horizontal surcharge. How do we do that? Similar to what we did with vertical effective stress, you simply multiply it with the coefficient. Now, if you multiply with the coefficient, madadagdag siya ngayon sa magko-contribute sa lateral earth pressure. So, now you will have the effects due to gamma 1, the effects due to gamma sat, and the effects due to gamma water, or gamma W, that is now unit weight of water, and of course, the effect of this surcharge when converted into a lateral pressure. So, that's that. I hope you learned something. Again, this is the first time I am doing this. Hope you enjoyed. I'll try to do better next time, of course. I'll be uploading this on YouTube. So hit like, hit here, click here, click here, click here. Okay, so subscribe na, payamanin na lang natin si Sir. Okay, ciao!